Hello, everybody. Vince Horn here with Mike Redmer and our special guest, Mikey Siegel. Two Mikeys, Mike and Mikey. Good to have you guys.
My 6-year-old calls me Mikey.
Yeah,
I'll be Mike for today's show.
All right, great. So we're here today kind of exploring this theme of contemplative technology. And Mikey is someone that I think, Mikey, I ran across your work originally when I saw you and Rohan Dixit working on the BrainBot project. And then since then, I know you've worked with a friend and teacher of mine as well, Kenneth Folk. So we've got a kind of shared background in the kind of noting meditation and geeky Theravada Buddhist world. And we were just talking before the show, Mike Redmer's got a background with Shinzen. So we've all kind of got this interesting geeky Burmese noting meditation background, so hopefully it won't get too nerdy in that respect when we start talking, but you never know. We're just here to talk about some of the work that Mikey's doing, which connects really deeply with the work that we're doing here with Buddhist Geeks, and we're going to explore enlightenment engineering and consciousness hacking and talk a bit about what those terms mean and where maybe this stuff is going. So, why don't we kick it off there? Consciousness hacking and enlightenment engineering. maybe we could just kick it off with those two ideas. What's going on there?
For sure. I see those as, thank you, both of you, for having me. This is fun to talk to you guys. I see those as two related but different threads. And they're both about this, meta approach to developing tools and technology for self-exploration. I've kind of been, the last few years, been sort of transitioned from a background in robotics and kind of dove headfirst into this space, which there isn't a lot of definition for. It's kind of new. You put a great title on a contemplative technology. I think that's a good term to put with it, but you can call it a lot of different things. But it's really about expanding the boundaries for the tools that we can use for exploring our own consciousness, for pursuing contemplative practice. The last year or so, or a year and a half maybe, I've been like head down in sort of prototype mode, building, tinkering, soldering iron, oscilloscope, totally geeking out, thinking about how I could actually build stuff. Mainly for myself, but I can see clearly, especially when I talk about it with people, that there's a much wider interest. And it strikes me that what I can do as an individual is very, very limited. And what I would love, in addition to my own prototyping and work that I'm excited about and continually doing, hopefully leading towards commercial products potentially, is making these ideas and tools and ways of thinking more widely accessible. One way of doing that is through an academic approach, and one way of doing that is through more of like the maker, DIY, hacker community. And so the Enlightenment Engineering thing is a... I'm kind of like in a round of applying to grad school, and this is a proposal for a PhD program, which would be sort of creating, as is defined in the PhD proposal, this field of enlightenment engineering, which is based on this already existing, rich, and somewhat mature, still maturing, but really, really powerful body of scientific exploration into meditation and contemplative practice. So we have this sort of science, this framework for understanding how does this work in the brain, how does this work in the body, how can this address clinical conditions, but we haven't really started to explore, well, how can we use that information in an applied way?
Right.
Now, we have done that using what we could call traditional technologies. And a traditional technology is like, you know, language or defined meditation techniques, or even a lot of like MBSR adaptations of traditional methodologies to sort of meet modern constraints in modern society. But we haven't really gone far past that. Some people like Judson Brewer are pushing that boundary, but there's a huge expanse of space outside of that. So partly it's me wanting to explore that myself, and partly this Enlightenment Engineering thing is saying, hey, we need to set an academic framework and precedent up in order to make it easy and acceptable for people to pursue these things, because right now it's taboo. And then the consciousness hacking thing is a similar concept, but much more in the DIY space. There's this huge availability now of resources that are totally accessible to you and me, anyone that has an inkling. Like, for example, there's like 5 or 6 commercially available consumer EEG headsets.
Yep.
And I don't even know what... I spend my life like watching this stuff, and I don't even know what people are doing with them. It's like not even clear. But there's a huge interesting space, for example, that people could be using those, a whole wide array of biosensing technology, and just like opening people up to this idea that, hey, there's all this technology, all these tools out there. You can actually begin developing stuff on your own for exploring your own consciousness, for creating new tools for self-awareness.
Nice. It almost sounds like, yeah, like the homebrew computer club for the mind or something.
Exactly.
Well, exactly. It's so funny because you had mentioned the EEG headsets, you know, and I'm thinking of NeuroSky in particular, and they had that one headset that attaches to a headband with, you know, those ears that perk up or go down, and I'm like, really? Like, you can read your brain waves, and this is what you're making? I think even these companies are like, I don't even really know how to best use it, and really they're relying on the development community to bring, you know, from all of these different avenues, whether it's gaming or more performance oriented like biohackers kind of approach, and the contemplative approach I think has a lot of things to bring to bear on those kind of technologies.
My sense, and this is, you know, my personal kind of frame on the world, is that there is a wave of technology that's being developed from this these consumer EEG headsets to a whole array of self-tracking and wearable technologies. And I look at the applications, and they're interesting, and sometimes they're sort of grasping at what seems like useful stuff, but my personal sense is, without knowing it, they're all driving towards the same thing, which is this underlying desire for increased self-awareness. Or as one way to put it, I think there's a lot of ways of putting it, but they're all sort of getting at this idea of tracking some aspect of who or what is happening, and then feeding it back to us in some way, and these ever-tightening loops of self-awareness. And so I think that this whole application towards contemplative stuff is like definitely one of the most interesting things. And with the EEG stuff, I think there's a interesting criteria you can use for sort of gauging how useful these things are, because there's a bunch of these sort of kind of cool seeming applications of these consumer EEG headsets. Is if you were to plug in completely random data, would the thing still be as interesting? And with most of these things, it's true. You could just plug in random data, and it would still be interesting.
So what do you mean by random data?
Oh, I'm sorry. I mean, like the way that people have used these EEG headsets. It's more the novelty, the concept that, oh, I'm using brainwave data to control, like, ears moving. Or there was another really cool project where a girl created these sort of little mini pools of water around her. And she would sit sort of in this meditative pose, and the water would vibrate based on the different bands of her EEG. And I love the concept, and it was a beautiful presentation, but you could stream random EEG data through her project, and she could still be sitting there, and it would still look just as cool and still have the same effect. So it almost didn't matter what the content of the EEG data was. So it was more of a superficial use of EEG like a token use of it rather than a real deep and meaningful use compared to, for example, what my buddy Rohan is doing with BrainBot, where he's trying to actually meaningfully use the EEG data.
Yeah, it almost seems like it's more in the realm of performance art that shows maybe a glimpse of what's possible in the future, but doesn't really do it in any concrete way.
Exactly.
Well, and another application that I saw that I thought was pretty interesting is they strapped an iPhone to the head, and they used some kind of like eye glass thing, and when the person was looking at something that interested them to a certain level, they had some kind of a baseline, and once that threshold was maxed, then they considered she is interested in what she's seeing. And so, and then it would take a photo or a video so that she could track throughout her day what she's seeing, what she's interested in, or what really grabbed her attention. And that kind of stuff is interesting, but it's almost like there needs to be a depth of this is at least from the contemplative angle. I think there's such a rich tapestry that contemplatives can bring, and especially contemplatives that are familiar with technology and that swim in it all the time and can think of and invent and create new ways of utilizing the technology to create meaningful experiences and deeper experiences. And I think this is what you're speaking to the DIY community. And I'd love to hear more about that in terms of what you have going on in your group and peers. Where do you see this DIY movement going, and what are some interesting things going on there?
Awesome. Yeah. So the project you mentioned, the NeuroCam, is a great jumping off point because it, like so many projects, rely heavily on a very conceptual or mind-oriented process where you are tracking or recording some kind of information, and then much later on, whatever it is, an hour, a day, a week later, you then look at some charts or graphs or some way of that information being represented, and then you learn something new, like new facts about yourself or something, and then that results in some kind of behavior change or new insight into yourself. And that's useful, and that's a classical approach to learning and all that stuff. But if you think about meditation ideally doesn't function in that way. Ideally, you're completely trying to bypass the mind, the whole conceptual system. You're not trying to get new facts, right? Sort of observe things in a way where you could write new stuff down necessarily. It's more experiential. And so my interest is really in how can we create new types of technologies that are specifically designed to bypass the whole obsessive mental tendency to conceptualize and think about stuff and ground us in a direct, non-judgmental, present moment experience. So technology for now, for this moment. And I think that there is a really wide array of ways you can approach this. I've been lately, for example, interested in wearable technologies. I'm interested in concepts like full-time, real-time feedback, where it's not session-based. The idea is about incorporating the technology into your everyday life. So a project I'm working on right now with a friend of mine, Bo, is a wearable EEG headband that connects to an iPhone app, and you would wear headphones, and you can wear this while you're working, while you're driving, while you're walking down the street. It creates a soundtrack to your mental activity, which at first sounds more just like, okay, that's interesting and novel, that could be kind of cool to listen to and work to, but it actually has an interesting utility to it. Because if this soundtrack directly maps to your mental states in a repeatable way, you can actually begin to learn the certain sounds that correspond to different mental states. Oh, what does mind wandering sound like? What does focused attention sound like? What does these different sort of subtle states of meditation sound like? And not only does that provide you with sort of insight into your inner process, it's sort of an alternate lens, but by the premise of neurofeedback and biofeedback, which is pretty well established, if you have this feedback and you know the state you're driving towards, in this case you know the sound that you want this to be because that corresponds to your desired state, you can then drive the system and continually reinforce your desired states or focused aware state using the soundtrack as a leverage point or as an anchor.
That's interesting. That's super cool. What have you found using these EEG headsets in terms of, I know when I was looking into it at one point, I was looking into NeuroSky and looking at their developer SDK, and there's certain algorithms that they provide in terms of filtering out all of the noise and kind of focusing on certain patterns and using that in terms of like an attentive state and a relaxed state. Mm-hmm. And those are kind of the two extremes that they use, in games and that kind of thing as control mechanisms and that kind of thing. But I was curious what your thoughts were on those algorithms and how are you guys using it in that particular product in terms of is it two particular states, or are you just reflecting back whatever's happening and it's up to the person to kind of make that correlation between this is what this subjective state feels like, this is what it sounds like, and just it's got a lot of variance.
So you can roughly separate feedback into what I would call biased and unbiased feedback. I don't know if there's like probably more official terms for that, but I made those up.
Biased feedback makes sense. That's good.
Biased feedback is traditional. That's what you'd almost always see. And that's where there's a desired state. And then for people that are unfamiliar with the concept of biofeedback or neurofeedback, I'll just explain it really quick. Are trying to use what's called feedback to try to reinforce some particular state. So classically, let's say I'm trying to change the temperature of my finger. Okay, I would have a temperature sensor on my finger, and then I would have a little gauge that would show me the temperature of my finger. And by seeing this gauge and then processing it through my eyes and into my brain, I can actually use that as a leverage point to actively and consciously change what, 60 years ago was thought to be a completely autonomic or uncontrollable kind of function. And so we can use that same premise now in really advanced ways. For example, we can use real-time fMRI, which can image little interior regions of our brain, and then some feedback on a screen showing us how activated or deactivated that region of the brain is. And we can actually change the way that that little inside region of the brain functions in this way. And it's really powerful. So that's
like what Judd's doing, right, with his work.
Exactly what Judd is doing. And there's actually, not to diverge too much, but like there was a lot of interest and exploration in the neurofeedback, biofeedback space in the 60s and 70s, and for various reasons, I've heard interesting stories explaining why, along with psychedelics research, all of that stuff, the funding got pulled, and it all sort of became eventually very taboo in academia. A lot of it got mushed together with sort of pseudoscience-y kind of new age sort of thinking, which the new age part is not necessarily bad, but it does not mix. It's like oil and water with academia. It got all mushed together, and so you just threw the baby out with the bathwater, and the whole thing got pushed out. And so now there's a new renaissance happening in the world of biofeedback, or in the world of neurofeedback, using these really advanced technologies like fMRI and MEG and dense EEG array spatial imaging. all this kind of cool stuff, and that's what Judd's doing. And so, but back to the biased, the biased and unbiased feedback. So biased feedback, also what Judd is doing, you have an idea of what you want to change. For example, you want to deactivate the PCC in the brain or something. And so you create a feedback system to drive towards that particular goal. Unbiased right. feedback is sort of like watching your breath. I mean, you could say reality is a form of unbiased feedback, maybe. But when you watch your breath, it's almost like the act of watching itself is the point. It is through becoming aware that the harmonization or the balance happens. And so, and it's almost like through this non-judgmental awareness, without having a desired state in mind, without having a directive or a goal, that you can get into, let's just say, a more interesting avenue, a more equanimous kind of space. And so if you can create an unbiased feedback that isn't saying, hey, this is the right way and this is the wrong way, then you can cut out a lot of the judgment factor, the self-criticism, the sort of anxiety and nervousness that can go along with trying to improve, trying to be better, I'm not doing good enough, or something like that. And so with this EEG project, I'm specifically trying to explore an unbiased feedback where you create as rich a mapping as possible between the sound and the mind states, where all relevant mind states are there, mapped uniquely to this whole wide space of sound. It could take you a month of wearing it to become familiar with this sound space. You know, it may not be an immediate thing. But the sound space doesn't say, oh, this sounds better and this sounds worse. It all just sort of has this sort of sound spectrum to it. And then you, in your own natural movement towards balance, would gravitate towards particular sounds or something like that.
Interesting. And do individuals have unique signatures, or is it, with the fidelity of the EEG right now, is it just a spectrum that if you do it long enough, eventually you'll experience all of those mind states as sounds? Or are individuals different? Are they getting different kind of sound feedback?
So this is still in the, I would say, experimental early phases, and I don't think I have enough data to give you a good answer to that. I think you were originally asking about like this NeuroSky headset and sort of the potential for these consumer EEG headsets. I think it's still an open question, because the question is, do the technologies that we're using have the ability to capture the correlates of the relevant mind states
right.
that we're after, or the relevant subjective states that we're after?
Like, how good is the resolution on that? How well does it correlate?
Exactly. And if like a single electrode from a relatively crappy EEG doesn't capture sort of in a unique way I guess what you could call a neural fingerprint of that desired state, where you could have a neural correlate of the desired state, but lots of other things could correlate if you have this really broad window. But what you really want is a neural fingerprint, where you have a sort of a much more unique correlation to that particular, in this case, like, you know, to that desired state, which would be this unique configuration of brainwaves. And so if you can get that, then you can be more confident that you're sort of guiding people in the right way. And the jury's still out. And the NeuroSky is like just the bottom of the barrel, in a sense. It's a single electrode. There's a few new devices coming out, like Interaxon is coming out with the device. Emotive is coming out with a new device. There's a Kickstarter out right now for a project called OpenBCI, which is an 8-channel EEG, more clinical grade. So there, you have a gradient now emerging of accessible EEGs that potentially have more resolution and access to more data.
Mm.
That's really interesting. I was curious to sort of switch gears a little bit to a different kind of project that I saw you talking about, which was something you did at Burning Man.
Oh.
And it seemed like you were using not EEG, but some other kind of measure. Was it the heart, like kind of heart sync kind of measurement? And now the reason I want to ask about this is because it's interesting to think about using some of these technologies individually, right? But it's also very fascinating to think about using them in a collective or social context. You know, how do our minds change when we're meditating together, for instance? You know, Kenneth Folk, who, you know, we all know really well, you know, one of the things he did was take a technique that had often been done or only been done individually and sort of say, hey, what if we did this socially? What if we, instead of noting our experience moment by moment in our own minds, we actually noted in a social situation? And those kind of things are really fascinating. I'm curious to talk about the potential of these technologies in terms of social exploration. And I know you did something at Burning Man, which is itself one giant social experiment. I've heard it called like kind of a religion of our generation. But I'm curious, what that was about and what you kind of what your thoughts are on the social dimension of this.
Cool. I am very interested in technology's ability to, in a real-time, present-moment sense, lower the perceived boundary between me and you, self and other. The HeartSync project was an effort in that direction. I've been thinking about this stuff for a while. I was really inspired by the book Nexus. Some really great scenes in there in the book where, you know, you have a room full of monks that have sort of, you know, have this this sort of basically operating system running in their brain that allows this sort of universal mental connectedness, all meditating in a room. Just a great image, really inspiring. I encourage people to read it to in a sci-fi sense, get inspired about these technology-facilitated group connectedness kind of concepts. And so the Burning Man thing, this HeartSync project, I was exploring this idea of, I guess it's what HeartMath calls coherence, and it's a, simply put, it's just a balanced physiological state where your heart rate is mapped to your breath in a natural way, and that when you inhale, your heart rate, if you're in a calm, balanced state, your heart rate will naturally increase when you inhale. Your heart rate will naturally go down when you exhale. And a bunch of other things physiologically will change in this rhythm with your breath. And if you were to look at someone, for example, who is meditating and breathing in a calm and regular way, you'll find this naturally happening. So this was sort of a physiological correlate, an anchor, that I could sort of drive people toward, well, that I could drive an individual towards, which is what's commonly happened. And my question that I was kind of putting out with this thing was, well, what if you were to drive an entire group towards a completely synchronized state of heart rate variability, where the whole group was both breathing together and all of their heart rates were increasing and decreasing in rhythm with each other? And so I created this system called HeartSync. It was actually originally funded by the Tech Museum in San Jose and will potentially or likely be incorporated into a permanent exhibit there. But this was the Burning Man project was a fun place to explore it. The setup is this audio-visual experience. You have a big sort of projection screen, sort of big speakers around you, and you sit down. I can do up to 6 people at a time. And you're all watching the screen, hearing the sounds, and the visuals and the sound are a constant reflection of the both each individual's state of internal balance, physiological balance, and the group's overall state of balance together. And so by watching this, and I kind of instruct people sort of what the visual cues are, but by watching this, visually, you can see the group coming into and out of this state of balance. And it's not an automatic thing. You really need to sit down, and like a meditation, you really need to sit with it. You really need to get synced up. And it, you know, sometimes takes 5 or 10 minutes for a group to, you know, initially reach this state of synchronization. But it definitely works in the sense that people do reach this physical state of balance. I'm not going to claim that I've created the sort of group enlightenment machine or something like that. I wish that was true. From the Burning Man experience and a number of other experiences, it was a really great success, and although people did have interesting, profound experiences, I'm not convinced that I probably could have shown them a video of like a unicorn jumping, and they probably would have had a profound experience too.
There are all sorts of extenuating circumstances at Burning Man.
We'll call them variables.
but the thing that I came out of it with, which was really profound, was realizing how hungry people are for a new relationship with technology. The technology that's increasingly surrounds us is really acting in direct opposition to the aims of contemplative practice. It's externalizing our intention, it's increasing the amount of content, increasing the amount of mental activity and noise, and decreasing our present moment and general ability to just focus on the phenomena in this moment as it arises, without judgment, without criticism, without continual wandering off into an alternate mental dimension. And so people were just refreshed. They were inspired, not even specifically by this project, but by the idea of, wow, this can be technology, this can be a future for technology. And it's that kind of inspiration that I would love to spread, that I would love to be able to show people, hey, you can also develop new technology that changes our relationship with these devices. I think that there's a lot of, I was just listening to, what was his name? It was like a couple interviews ago. I can't remember his name, but
Chris Dancy.
No, he's like the technology theorist, Rushkoff.
Oh, yeah. Douglas.
Douglas Rushkoff. Yeah. Yep. And there's another, like Sherry Turkle also is another one. They have these great critiques of our relationship with technology, and I think they're all very valid. And the question is, well, what do you do with that? And I think that there are approaches that act in opposition to that, which I think is totally valid and natural, and those try to say things like, okay, you need to take an hour a day, just unplug, you know?
Right, unplugging is the big thing, right?
Exactly, and I think that's great. If you can get people to unplug, that's marvelous, if that's helpful, but that requires behavior change, behavior modification, which is hard to do, and you're sort of going against the grain in a sense, and I think that, in addition, say, well, how can we go with the grain? What can we do to leverage this already existing propensity for people to look to technology to solve their problems, which you could say is a negative trait, and you say, well, how can we sort of take that and use it as like a trick, you know, to then ride that wave and develop technology based on that, that just redirects attention back to the self, redirects attention back to the present moment. So that's kind of what HeartSync is trying to do, and I guess that's what I'm trying to do with most of the stuff I'm doing.
Great. This is awesome, dude. Cool. Thanks for sharing that. I'm thinking, just because of the time, do we want to kind of switch to questions now and bring some of the folks who are obviously here and enjoying the conversation into it? Does that sound good for you guys?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think the first question there really ties into the point you were just making. Alan was asking, is the aim of enlightenment engineering creating experiences or developing skills? Experiences are fleeting and usually dismissed by meditation masters as something to get beyond. Skills, on the other hand, are presumably cumulative. So what do you think, Mikey? What is the aim of enlightenment engineering, would you say?
I would say the aim, that's a very interesting question, and I'd love to dive into the distinction between those things more, but I'm actually going to dodge it by saying that I think the aim is more meta beyond those two things. I think enlightenment engineering is really just trying to set a precedent for the scientific approach to developing these tools and technologies, and within the umbrella of that approach, you can explore both of those paths.
Right.
And then have the language and discipline and foundation to decide those kinds of forks in the road, or you know, explore both, you know, systematically with new technologies, and then see what works and what doesn't.
It's sort of striking me, like having this conversation for the first time, that you know, the one of the critiques that I often hear, or the concerns about technologies, and I love what you just said, by the way, Mikey, and I want to go into that too, but
cool.
It is that, you know, these things are sort of enhancements to help us learn something, but we become dependent on them. And what I'm just realizing now is, well, yeah, but do you become dependent on things that are always available now? You know, do we become dependent on our, you know, prefrontal cortex? Yes, we're very dependent on our prefrontal cortex. In the same way, like if technology isn't going away, and if unplugging, you know, it might be like a good ritual for some people, but not really a tenable lifestyle. You know, in that sense, I was just thinking these technologies, especially with wearables on the way, you know, they will become an extension of ourselves. And in that sense, why would we be concerned about whether or not they're separate from us or not, boosting us or not? Because if they're always there, then it doesn't really, that point doesn't really make any sense. Anyway, just wanted to share that thought because it seems a little connected to the skills based development thing.
Yeah, and there are really effective treatments for epilepsy that are completely closed loop systems that have an EEG embedded in the brain and electrical stimulation, and without conscious control, when a certain pattern is sensed, electrical stimulation ensues, and it can control these seizures. And you know, there's a completely embedded form of technology. Is that right? Is that wrong? You know, open. You know, that's the question.
And do we really want to go back to the you know, like, let's say early 90s or 80s? You know, when we were all unplugged. I mean, was it so much better then? Really?
Well, I mean, just listen to the music. It was so depressing. I think because there wasn't any technology.
I remember my mind wandering quite a bit.
Yeah.
Going into the point you made too, Mikey, about you know, kind of creating an umbrella for both of those to be explored, I think that's one of the interesting things that this kind of DIY attitude brings to the conversation, that's different from the contemplative traditions, because the contemplative traditions, they always had particular aims, right? Like particular agendas.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, hey, here's this particular method, here's the model that you need to understand to get these results. Well, there's no space within that to kind of question whether or not you want those results. And maybe you want some different kind of results, or maybe you want to explore something else. To me, this sort of broadens and opens the possibilities a lot in terms of what kind of consciousness do we want to develop, and what do we want to notice about our experience. And that becomes a kind of really interesting question when we don't have so much like developed traditions telling us what we should be experiencing, but we have to kind of figure that out ourselves.
Yeah, we not only confuse the finger for the moon, but we're like very attached to that finger, you know, like I don't want any other finger, I only want that one finger, you know, and that particular finger, this is debated, but the particular like conceptual structure, the pointers, can lead to specific flavors of experience, you know? And so the question is, if you're willing to discard all the existing pointers, all the existing conceptual structures, and really build totally new ways of pointing, what types of new flavors of experience can you lead people to?
Yeah, so what types of new ones? And then my question is, and how can you take what's already been developed, like if we already have this amazing resource of all these different contemplative traditions, mm-hmm. how can we translate those into, yep. you know, into these mediums as well?
Yep, all good trajectories.
Nice. Okay, another question here from Marie Ramos. Marie says, have any of you guys heard of this or tried it? It's a technology for lucid dreaming called Sleep with Remy.
It's the Remy mask.
Oh, Remy. Okay, thanks. I was yeah. sort of interpreting that as a Buddhist term for some reason.
I think Remy, like R-E-M, I think it's kind of their play on
yeah.
that.
Yeah, sleep with REMEE.com. I've heard of it, but I haven't tried it or played with it.
I have that device in my like growing collection of like every tech thing I can find. There's a specific answer to that question and a broad answer to that question. Specifically, like I think the Remy's cool. It's open loop, which means it doesn't use feedback. It just blinks lights at a set time. Which
right.
I think, as far as lucid dreaming goes, it's more effective if you can sense. That REM state of sleep using EEG is the gold standard, and then blink at the proper time. There's a current Kickstarter right now which actually can do that. More broadly,
Do you remember the name of the Kickstarter? Because I saw something recently too that I backed it, but then it got pulled off the shelf, and it was going to use audio. Q with EEG as a lucid dreaming thing, but this sounds like a different one. Do you remember the name of it by chance?
We'll
see how quick your Kickstarter Googling skills are here.
Man, Kickstarter is the platform for this kind of stuff. I mean, the wearables, the EEG, they're really, you know, pushing the boundaries of
it's
innovative like hardware and software. I mean, it's really cool.
Yeah, it's amazing. Yeah, I want, at one point when we interview Vincent, I want to hear about that Contemplative Technology conference was an interesting Kickstarter. It's called Neuro-On, by the way.
Neuro-On.
Yeah, it's described as being for polyphasic sleep, but it has EEG built in, and they specifically mentioned lucid dreaming there. It has EEG and the ability to blink lights, which is mainly what you would need.
Very cool. Okay,
interesting, cool.
Yeah.
All right. Good questions. Maybe let's do a couple more. So Sue Thomas, she said, Mikey, from what I can see, most of all the apps in development in this area are iPhone only. Is this because Android can't yet provide the necessary functionality?
No. I think that people just from a commercial perspective like to develop on iOS maybe first, but actually in some ways Android even has a little bit more compatibility because it's a little bit more open in terms of like the ways you can use hardware. So arguably Android is even like a little bit of a better development platform, but I don't think there's any like deep technical reason why it's one versus the other. I think it's more cultural.
Yeah.
I would say too that on the Apple platform, you're generally, as a developer, you're generally going to be able to make a little bit more money because a lot of the statistics show that users are more freely spend more money on apps. So it might be a little bit more enticing sometimes, but
right from the like business development standpoint.
Yeah, from the business. Yeah. Developer standpoint.
Sure. Another question here from John Simon, our friend John. Can Mikey tell us about any of the devices he's currently soldering together for his own work? what's behind you in the little in the workshop there? I see an elephant or something in a hammock.
I know. I've been looking at that the whole time and just kind of.
It's a hippo. This is the workshop over here. I don't know how
nice.
You can see that.
That's cool.
Yeah, this is Joy Labs. This is our workspace.
Sweet.
Kind of has a cool little mural on the wall over here.
You are living the cliche, Mikey. Oh, I have to say.
Man. In Santa Cruz. I mean, we have a circle of fake grass. I mean, you don't. It doesn't get. I mean, you wouldn't.
Is that your putting green?
Huh?
Is that your putting green?
Yeah. you wouldn't believe the cliches that happen around here. It's remarkable. So in terms of what's happening now, I talked about like the EEG headband. Here's like, for example, this is like, you know, prototype for the headband, very like prototypey. I got little circuits and stuff. There's different stuff. I'm toying with an idea for sort of a more upper scale platform for call it a meditation technology, something that you might not wearable, not in your home, but something that you might have in your house, kind of up on an altar or something, like a beautiful object that you could use in your practice. In terms of what I'm building right now at this moment, I'm mainly working on that EEG headband. I've had some funny projects in the past. I had a project that was exploring this wearable technology stuff. It was actually a pair of glasses that provided this full-time, real-time feedback on my heart rate in real time, just as an experiment to see what I could do with this concept. And again, this is like the biofluency thing. I wasn't trying to drive towards a specific heart rate, like lowering or raising it. I was just reflecting my heart rate. And after about 3 days of wearing it, I could consciously control my heart rate between 40 and 70 beats per minute.
Wow.
Just watching the numbers, I could just change it consciously.
Wow.
Really interesting. But again, that was not that useful beyond just sort of a physiological trick. So I think there's a much, much deeper space of exploration.
Interesting. Yeah, and it's
very cool.
The unbiased stuff, I wanted to go back to that too, because it just strikes me as being almost similar to the difference between like a kind of focused attention practice or like a particular cultivation practice and a more choiceless awareness practice where you're simply aware of whatever arises moment by moment. And I was just imagining like what it would be like to sit and listen to the soundtrack without necessarily trying to direct it anywhere, but just noticing the kind of soundtrack of my mind and experience kind of floating through, and that would be pretty cool.
One project you should check out, it's called Sound Self by a guy named Robin Arnott.
Okay.
And cool dude. He submitted a talk for the upcoming conference. I hung out with him for a while. He lives in Austin. And in terms of this unbiased feedback, I think he's got one of the coolest projects around. He's from the gaming world. So he doesn't have the languaging or even necessarily the conscious focus on meditation, although like in talking to him, he's clearly on the same page and driving towards that. He's just coming at it with sort of a gaming framework. But it's a game with no beginning and no end. You know, it's very much like if in the gaming world, you know, classical gaming is this concentration type of meditation, this is the like open focus kind of unbiased kind of meditation approach equivalent. So that's an existing project worth checking out.
Mm, cool. Let's see, another one here. Marie, just a follow-up comment. She said, responding to the comment that we made, what we want to notice about our experience. Yes, and what's the motivating force of using a particular tool? I don't quite remember the reference there. Do you guys remember?
What she's saying. It's about it. I can't quite anchor that into to a thing. What we want to notice by using a
Q&A app facilitator fail. Sorry, Marie.
We're just gonna sit in the mystery right now.
A moment of silence for that question.
Um, OK, Okay, Edgar's got a kind of comment here as well. He says, I believe as long as the current system is based on accumulation of wealth, i.e. money, technology represents 70% hell, 30% heaven. So just a comment to throw out there.
30%.
70% hell.
How are you coming 30%. Up with those figures?
I want some equation. I want to see the derivation.
I want to see this algorithm. Interesting. We get a lot of comments, actually. Like, I mean, there's a lot of kind of this general sentiment I've noticed in these conversations.
This is a privileged approach. I mean, I don't deny that. This is specifically catering not only toward, it's catering towards me, essentially, you know, and then the reflection of that. So this is like catering towards the largely mentally created suffering that we have in the West, where all of a sudden you have enough resources that it's very clear that it's just your mind, just your you know, the thoughts you have about your context rather than the context itself that is the problem. And I don't think that comes into play when you're worrying about what you're going to eat.
Sure,
as much.
Sure. And it's, you know, I've been kind of fascinated with this internet philosopher named Alexander Bard recently. He's I think it's just his style of talking and also his ideas are really compelling. But he talks a bit about a shift toward what he calls attentionalism, away from more capitalist structures. And he sort of equates, you know, the shift from the aristocratic sort of feudal models where everything was based in the country to the shift, you know, that happened with the French Revolution and the Western Enlightenment, where capitalism sort of came online, everything moved into urban areas. You know, he sort of suggests that we're already in the middle of a shift anyway toward different kinds of, and Burning Man maybe is a kind of microcosm of that, you know, where the internet and the logic of networks becomes the kind of basis upon which our economic and social activity are kind of moving. And I wonder, you know, if we're in store for some pretty big shifts when it comes to this stuff. Because I imagine, you know, like if I could just do this sort of work in a way that was based on how much value it provided versus, you know, how much money I could make doing it, I'd have to say that I would prefer that model. You know, if the attention were more of a what kind of fueled this kind of work. I'm curious, yeah, Mike, if you've thought about that, you know, because we are operating within a particular economic system, and we may or may not like aspects of that.
Wait, was that from Mikey or Mike?
Well, both of you. You guys are both doing work, but I particularly Mikey, but Mikey number two, you know, if you want to chime in, of course.
Well, I was just going to bring up Kickstarter and say, I mean, this is a perfect example of a platform that is, you know, there's a lot of technology on there, and it's allowing people who, you know, don't really have a lot of means in terms of financing and that kind of thing to be able to post their ideas and to come up with new concepts and to test that out with the community. And there's been a lot of valuable products and projects that have come through that platform, and it's all being allowed to happen through technology, through the internet, you know. So there's a lot of ways in which technology is, equalizing things. It's been a great equalizer, you know, in terms of economic disparity and that kind of thing.
Yeah, I guess there's a question of how much do we have to change, and how much does the world have to change in order to realize what you're pointing towards? I sort of adopt the approach, this sort of framework that for people to live in that way, most fundamentally the world has to change from the inside out. So that's kind of part of like what my vision, my sort of personal vision of saving the world or whatever. It's like, in order to save the world, it's not for me about specifically, first and foremost, changing like the economic structure or allowing different like socially structured criteria for how we work and why we work, but getting to the very heart, the very core of human experience and our sense and our sort of imposed sense of disconnectedness and separateness, and really getting deeply at that. And if we can change that on an individual level, how does that then trickle out and spread and change society from in sort of a grassroots way from the inside out? Almost like a question mark. What society will come from those basic ingredients, rather than this is what society should be like, you know, kind of thing.
All right. Well, this feels like a good place to end. We're at the end of the hour, and we were able to take some good questions, and just, I feel like we just started to scrape the surface of what we could talk about, so we should definitely do this again. And Mikey, I'm thinking, you know, if you ever decide to bring the consciousness hacking exploration online, the Buddhist Geeks community probably find some pretty good consciousness hackers in there too, so let us know. We'd be happy to host you.
If you're in, that's awesome, and if you're in San Francisco or Santa Cruz, there's two consciousness hacking meetups, one in San Francisco, one in Santa Cruz, that you can sign up for that, you know, will be a reoccurring event if you want to do that in person as well.
Nice.
Great.
All right. Well, thank you, guys. Good to have you on the show, and let's do it again sometime soon.
Awesome. Looking forward to it. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, thanks, Mikey.